Hi guys. It is a fairly nice day here in the end times in paradise in St. Croix, Virgin Islands. We have somehow limped into, what is it, Thursday, April 7th, 2016, I believe. So anyway, maybe I will start a new Thursday rant if I can do this every Thursday. Perhaps this has something to do with the new Yahoo News format, but there is actually, all joking aside, some good news on the eco-Nazi front right here in the mainstream media. We're going to do a good news roundup. All joking aside. All right, but we're going to start out, I think I've got like five stories here on the top headlines on the planet today. And this first story, I've done this, I've had several versions of this rant before, but it's finally showing up in the mainstream media about what I have often stated as the number one most hopeful spot on planet Earth. If I had to search this planet up and down looking for hope, there is one place to find it. And let the mainstream media tell you all about it. In Chernobyl nuclear zone, animals thrive without humans. This is my latest rant that the jury is in, the verdict is in, that virtually every other species of Earthling we share this planet with would rather take their chances at ground zero of perhaps the single biggest nuclear catastrophe in history. They will thrive better at ground zero there than what they will trying to coexist with the single biggest threat to the planet, which is humans. Just plain old everyday humans going about their daily business are a bigger threat to every Earthling we share this planet with than a nuclear meltdown. And thank you for the mainstream media. It's working its way up. It's taken years. This is, I guess, good God, they're going back with these 30-year-plus studies. And here's the latest news. So what happens to the environment when humans disappear? 30 years after the Chernobyl nuclear disaster, booming populations of wolf, elk, and other wildlife in the vast contaminated zone in Belarus and Ukraine provide a clue. So I guess April 26th will be the 30th anniversary of when 100,000 people had to abandon the area permanently, leaving native animals the sole occupants of a cross-border exclusion zone, meaning human exclusion zone, roughly the size of Luxembourg. And today, in parts of the zone, tumble-down villages marked with yellow and red radiation warning signs have become hunting grounds for predators such as wolves and hawks, while birds, including tawny owls and magpies, nest in the roofs and chimneys of the abandoned building. And then they have a little photo gallery, links to that. This is the Ukrainian ecology minister, Hanna Vronska, and I've never really understood this statement, but I'm cheering it on. Although, to be perfectly honest, guys, I think this is a little bit unadulterated horseshit. I wish this were true. quote, people can never live there. It's impossible, not even for the next 24,000 years. Ecology minister is talking about the 1,000 square miles of forest, marsh, and open countryside. And I love this sentence. The long-term impact of the radiation on an animal population is a subject of intense debate, because scientists have struggled to untangle the positive effects of human absence from the negative effects of living in an environment poisoned by the humans. And guess what is the clear answer? Well, despite the radiation, wolf numbers are now over 7 times higher in the zone compared with uncontaminated areas elsewhere. What they mean by uncontaminated is areas where humans still live. This is no shit Sherlock eco-Nazism 1, 2, 3. The single best way to save the planet is to get the fucking humans off the planet. You know? DDD. And, so of course, now, Vronska said, authorities are considering turning the uninhabitable zone, the human uninhabitable zone, into a biosphere to protect and study its native animal populations and what would become the largest nature reserve in Europe. There you go. All right. Let's listen to some comments. You've already heard my comments. I love this. LOL. Only the left-wing media could turn Chernobyl into an argument against people. No humans equal the return of Eden before humans spoiled it. There you go. You go, you left-wing media. This has nothing to do with left-wing, right? I guess it's those left-wing wolves over there. It is the left-wing media. Here is, nature always finds a way, in particular after humans screw things up. Here is, just goes to show that nature will continue on long after humans have died off. There you go. All right, anyway, I gotta move ahead here. I would like to read some more comments, but let's go from Chernobyl to, unbelievably, some good news coming out of Yellowstone about Yellowstone bison. Yellowstone bison granted more home to roam. I've been having this rant for years that it is goddamn about time to let these native wild bison who come out of Yellowstone National Park, which is still has this big hunk of 330,000 acres of our public lands right outside the park. But what's been going on for the past 100 years, if the bison who have been here for how many millions of years step outside of the national park into the national forest, the goddamn beef ranchers taking them out, slaughtering them. I better fix this tripod before this camera blows away. So there you go. I do not believe it. The country's largest band of wild bison can roam public lands outside its home at Yellow National Park without facing certain slaughter under an agreement reached by U.S. state and tribal leaders on Wednesday. The plan allows the bison to range on more than 330,000 acres of public lands in Montana. The deal is a step toward ending this unadulterated horseshit 16-year program during which thousands of bison have been rounded up and slaughtered after wandering outside the boundaries of the park. There you go. Where was it talking about? Oh, here we go. The practice of capturing bison outside the park and limiting capturing. That's another word for putting a bullet through their head. Capturing. The practice of slaughtering bison outside the park on our public lands and limiting their numbers within Yellowstone stems largely from cattle industry concerns that stray bison could transmit a disease that causes cows to miscarry. Yellowstone bison have been exposed to disease, but there is no known case in which it has been transmitted in the wild from a bison to a domestic cow, government wildlife manager said. Not one time. But guess where the bison got the damn disease? They got it from the invading cows. It was the cattle industry that got the bison sick. And it's been now what's been getting the bison killed. Thank you, federal, state, and tribal agencies, for pulling your head out of your ass and telling the Ammon Bundy gang to go fuck themselves. You know? And now the bison are leading the way, and let the wolves and grizzly bears follow suit. It is time to shut down the beef industry on our public lands. End of story. It is this tiny little industry lining the pockets of a tiny number of multimillionaire welfare ranchers sucking at the tit of the U.S. taxpayers, the U.S. government that they profess to despise. They're a bunch of fucking whiny, coward bullies, and it's time for those fuckers to go, and maybe this is the first step in the right direction. Okay, as long as we're generally in that area of the country, here we go again, up there, and this is the Klamath River in Northern California. Officials sign unusual pact to tear down hydroelectric dams. All right. Derek Jensen celebrating today, and no doubt, endangered salmon blocked for nearly a century from hundreds of miles of the Klamath River in Oregon and California are expected to return in mass. We'll see about that. Under unusual agreement signed Wednesday to tear down four hydroelectric dams. Hopefully the plan will bring about one of the largest river restoration projects in the history of the U.S. The dams now block fish from migrating to their historic spawning grounds and also degrade water quality, spreading fish diseases and algae blooms. So when are they going to start tearing these things down? Jesus, this goes on and on. It would be real nice to know when they're actually going to start tearing. Okay. They're going to begin the deconstruction in 2020. I don't know why. I think a few sticks of dynamite tomorrow would be a good start. But of course, guys, you know, while your old eco-Nazi is joining Derek Jensen and celebrating this good news, of course, for every dam being torn down in the United States, we have about 300 going up all over the Amazon jungle, sub-Saharan Africa, and Southeast Asia. But again, 4 is a good start, but it's not nearly enough. Okay, now we're gonna move to where you almost never, when was the last time we had any good eco-Nazi news coming out of Cambodia? I mean, how can you argue with this, I guess, being good news? Cambodia to repopulate forests with tigers from abroad. Cambodia has unveiled a plan to reintroduce tigers from abroad into the dry forests of the country, where the big cat has become virtually extinct thanks to poaching. So between 20 and 50 tigers are still believed to exist in Cambodia, but years of illegal poaching of the tigers as well as their prey led to a dramatic decline in their population. Oh, I'm sorry, this was the last, back in 2007, and the last tiger spotted in Cambodia was seen in 2007, and today there are no longer any breeding populations of tigers left in Cambodia, and they are therefore considered functionally extinct. And so what they're going to do is bring in 7 or 8 new tigers. And I'm cheering on this plan, but there's just one problem, as this guy named Humpty Dumpty pointing this out. While this news is heartening, I am also quite sure the folks cheering it the most are the future tiger poachers who will take this handful of sacrificial lambs out within a few weeks of releasing them. The answer is not increasing the number of tigers, it is decreasing the number of humans. I think we've already been over this in the Chernobyl story. Obviously, other people are agreeing with me. Here's Mike. So, they're going to bring back tigers that have been wiped out due to poaching and are somehow going to protect them this time? Here's Carrie. If they could not stop the poachers before, what makes them think they can protect those tigers now? And somewhat along those same lines, we're going to go to the good old state of Florida and the country of Mexico, where we see this good news headline: green sea turtles of Florida and Mexico no longer endangered. They are, of course, now only threatened breeding populations on the beaches of Florida and the west coast of Mexico are still considered threatened. But in Florida alone, last year, there's some 2,250 nesting females, up from a handful in 1978 when the breeding populations were first listed as endangered. So this is a great news that this is one more example of the Endangered Species Act being one of the most important acts ever. But I'm going through this story looking for the words sea level rise. Sea turtles have long faced a host of threats, from beach development that destroyed their nesting habitat to pollution to fishing nets that entangle them. And this, of course, is going on right down here at the bottom of this hill in St. Croix. But there's one problem with this story, guys. While again, like the tigers, it's damn good news. But where the hell are these sea turtles in Florida going to be nesting in a few years? Where are the daughters of these 2,250 breeding females? Where the hell are they going to be laying their eggs in a few years? In the goddamn lobby of the Miami Hilton? You know, I've never seen this story talked about. There's this big sea turtle education sign right down here at the sea turtle nesting beach at Sandy Point, you know, talking about all of this. I've never seen it discussed. What the fuck is going to happen to sea turtles all over this planet as the beaches where they lay their eggs disappear under the water? You know? Yeah, I mean, we can cheer on the news in 2016, come back in 2036, and let's read this same headline. Let's see how unendangered sea turtles are at that point and any other animal that depends on a coastal ecosystem on this planet. From here to the Marshall Islands and everywhere in between. Anyway, never let it be said that Hambone Littletail does not share some good news, but don't worry, I will be coming back at you with my next rant. The apocalypse. Here is when science says the world will end. But that is another rant coming up in 1 minute for this good news eco-Nazi roundup. Bye, guys.